with reference to the growth of the tree, I have knocked off 99%, only 1% is remaining. What is that 1%? I brought it from the nursery. I put water to it. That is all you can, now that is, so the kartrutvam came to that level. Now, I tell you, so these hands and legs, that is the kartrutvam, because of them you are assuming, hands are given and legs are given. And then, so the capacity for the hands to hold on to something and for the legs to walk is given. That Shakti is the manifestation of Ishvara, it is given to you. You have not created it yourself. And then, okay, so hands is gone, legs is gone. So 1% is gone. So 0.1%. What is that? I took the decision, though the hands and legs are kshetraman, therefore it is not me, therefore that their action cannot be my action, but I took the decision to bring it. But then Bhagavan said, buddhir buddhimatamasmi. So if the buddhi is me, and the other day Buddha Swamiji is telling the thought is Ishvara, the next thought, the next moment thought, what is going to come, can you tell? You cannot tell. And then can you control the coming five thoughts, the coming from this moment onwards, five thoughts, can you control them? You cannot control. Then you claim that mind is mine, buddhi is mine. Where is this claim? You do not know what is the next, I don't know what is the next word that is going to come. And I do not have any control of any sort on the mind and buddhi. It is so chanchalam like mercury. So, where is the question of control? I am unable to control it. I don't have any say in its functioning. Yet I say, it is mine or it is me. And take the agency onto my head. So where is kartrutvam? How much kartrutvam is now left with me? Zero. So, I tell you, people in their folly, they put this kartrutvam on their head. Atma, which is you, is never the karta. This is a very clear understanding one should have. So, this understanding is, Bhagavan repeats himself again and again and again. He says that you are not the karta. So, in this regard, you are one with Ishvara. Ishvara is not the karta. Aham akarta. That is what Ishvara says. And he says, you are also a karta. He doesn't say, you are a kinkara, you are a dasa, therefore go on doing dasyam to me for the entire life after life. He doesn't say all that. All this is said by somebody else, not by Bhagavan. So, Bhagavan says, you are created in my image. You are like me. You are also not karta. You are thinking that you are karta. You are a murkhaha. He says that. So, prakrute striyamanani, gunais karmani sarvashaha, ahankar vimudhatma kartahamiti manyate. So, he uses rather strong language. You cannot abuse in road language, you know. So, he says ahankar vimudhatma means that is the strongest denunciation that he can do. He cannot further come down than that. So, what more you want him to say? So, ahankar vimudhatma kartahamiti manyate. So, you are not the karta. He says five agents are there in kartrutvam. And he establishes that atma is not the karta at all. You see, in your presence actions take place. You are not the karta. In your presence actions take place. It is like even the sun is rising in the east. I mean, whatever appears, I don't mean that sun is going around the earth. I am not saying that. It appears. That is a natural phenomenon you can see every morning. So the sun rises in the east. So in the Yajnashala, the Pratasavanam starts. So in the sunlight, in the prakasha given by the sun, with the energy provided by the sun, the Yajamani performs Yajnam. And at the same time, a daylight robbery or a daylight murder is done. So now, sun, when he makes a yajnam possible, is he, some punya goes to him? When he makes a daylight robbery and murder possible, some papa goes to him? He neither punyam nor papam. Atma is just like that. Atma is just like that. Atma is this sun, with reference to this body. What all actions are taking place in this body? Atma is only the witness. Atma provides, in the sannidhi, in the presence of Atma, actions are taking place. So same is the case with Ishvara. Therefore, Ishvara doesn't have any kartrutvam whatsoever. Yet, he undertakes, incarnation. He doesn't have janma, but incarnation. He doesn't have a kartrutvam, but karmas going on. What type of karmas? We will see that, what type of karmas are going on. So, na nama rupe guna dosha evava. Ishvara doesn't have nama and rupa. Nama and rupa are the intrinsic properties of Ishvara. What is ghatam? Nama and rupa. This ghatam will be there with us. Ghatam and necklace and gold, these things will be there with us. As long as Vedanta is there, these things will be there. And I sometimes feel, let me bring in some other example. But no other example looks as precious, as fresh, and as clean as ghata and necklace. These two are the best examples. Any number of times, they look fresh to me. I don't know about these shrotas, but they look fresh to me. So, this the ghatam is there. What is a ghatam? It is nothing but a form, and a name goes along with it. The moment you have a form, a name goes, this is human nature is like that. A form is there, immediately a name is given. Therefore, it's a form and a name. Now, this nama and rupa, are they intrinsic to the clay? No, they are not intrinsic to the clay. Because if they were to be intrinsic to the clay, then clay can become part alone, it cannot become anything else. Because ghatatvam is intrinsic to it, so it can be converted into part alone. But fortunately it is not so. They are not intrinsic to clay, and hence clay can become any of these things. Similarly, Shri Krishna e nama. So that Tribhangi, etc. The other day I was describing the Lord Krishna's Shabda Chitram. So that kind of even Vamshi Vibhushita Karati is a Shabda Chitram alone. So that particular form of Lord Krishna, it is called Rupa. This nama and rupa, are they intrinsic to Ishvara? There are some who say that. It is not correct. If they are intrinsic to Ishvara, you cannot have Shri Krishna. You can have only Shri Krishna, not Shri Rama, not Dakshinamurti, not any other thing. So, what a funny conclusion it is. Such a god is called a jealous god. A Semitic god is a very jealous god. The Semitic god cannot tolerate any other god. So whereas the Hindu god is not a jealous god. He is all-pervading and a very tolerant god he is. So Lord Krishna, if you are worshipping, God is happy. Suppose you stop worshipping Krishna and now you worship Rama, he is equally happy. He is not jealous about it. This person has gone away from my fold. That kind of a problem he doesn't have. He is not a jealous god. So this nama and rupa, nama rupa, they are mithya. They cannot have any existence outside the satya vastu. Ishvara is the satya vastu. So nama rupa cannot exist outside Ishvara. And Ishvara doesn't have nama and rupa as intrinsic attributes to him. Matsthani sarva bhutani. Nacha matsthani bhutani means that. So it is like asking a you have seen a snake in the rope. Is there snake in the rope? Yes, I have seen it. Is there snake in the rope? No, it is not there. It is like that. Hero and heroine are dancing on the screen. What are they doing? They are dancing. Are they really dancing? Oh no, they are not dancing. Hero is in one town and heroine is another town. Nobody is dancing there. So, but then, are they not dancing? Yeah, they are dancing. So this is like that. You cannot define it as sattvenava, asattvenava, nirvaktum na shakyate. That is maya. Therefore, na nama rupe. Guna dosha evava. You see, if you have kartrutvam, then dosha is inevitable. Guna is inevitable. Punyam and papam will become inevitable. This kartrutvam, if you take on your head, I tell you, you will end up either in swargam or narakam. It is inevitable. Shall I give you a small story about it? So I will not be able to finish this loka anyway. Tathapi lokapyaya sambhavaya. So though I do not have the kartrutvam, still I take birth. So all contradictions are reconciled from the different perspectives of mithya as well as satyam. The story about Kartrutva is a very interesting story. I suddenly remembered. I don't know whether it is interesting or not. You judge it. So one gentleman is traveling from Hyderabad to Chennai. He entered into Chennai Express. It comes to Vijayawada station by night 1 o'clock. So he was sleeping in the middle berth. And the lower berth one person was occupying and he got down at Vijayawada. Everybody wakes up at Vijayawada. Because even at midnight at 12 o'clock, this coffee and tea, they make so much racket. They enter the compartments also and make so much racket. So you, no question of sleeping. Vijayawada station means even Kumbhakarna cannot sleep there. He has to wake up. So this gentleman sleeping on the middle berth, he woke up. He observed a new passenger has entered into the compartment. People carry a lot of luggage, you know, nowadays they carry big, big luggages and trunks and all that. So anyway, he carried a trunk. He pushed the trunk underneath the seat. And he lied down on the lower berth. So now the station was left behind, the train is travelling. So early morning 4:30, Nellur, this gentleman, this middle berth gentleman, he woke up. He found that the lower berth fellow is no more lying there. He got down somewhere. By Nellur, at the Nellur station he got down. So then he got up, he wanted to go to bathroom, he came down and then he wanted to sleep for some more time. It is only 4:30, 4:45. Suddenly to his utter amazement, he found that the trunk is there only. The trunk which was brought by this gentleman at Vijayawada station, it is there. Then he thought maybe the person is somewhere around. He is a very bulky person and all that, so he must be somewhere around. So he slept. He got up at 6 and immediately observed about the trunk. It is still there. And this gentleman is nowhere. So by 9 o'clock in the morning, he reached the Chennai station. And then the trunk is there. And that bulky man, that hefty gentleman is nowhere to be seen. So he collected his own luggage and he waited. All the people got down. Nobody is claiming the trunk. In the meanwhile, these coolies, you know, they make a lot of noise. Sar, 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 like that, they come after you for... So one coolie came. Initially he refused him, but still this gentleman was sitting there, only one person is left in the compartment. So the coolie thought probably he is looking for a coolie. So he jumped forward. Sir, coolie, are you coming? He said, yes. So immediately the coolie, a trunk amara hai, yeah? So he took out the trunk and his own luggage. So the coolie and the trunk and that suitcase or trunk, whatever, they are coming. At the gate, the ticket collector said, Kiska hai ye trunk? This man told, Mera hai, it is mine. It appears to be heavy. Then he told the coolie, it has to be weighed. So they weighed it. There is always a balance nearby. They weighed it. They found it is extra weight. So the ticket collector told, sir, you have to pay 85 rupees extra. So he immediately paid it and took a receipt and came out. And he put the trunk in the coolie put the trunk in a taxi. And they are about to close the dickey of the taxi when a policeman, generally policeman will be idling in some corner. Police people generally they stop a scooterist fellow and collect 10 rupees and they are happy with it. They don't do nothing more than that. So this policeman, he observed this, his trunk happens to be quite heavy and he putting it in the dickey. And this gentleman, he's a little shaky. Some doubt he got. This man's prarabdha was somewhat different. So he came and told on Lati, what is this trunk, bhai? What is this trunk? What is there in it? This man told, books are there. It is heavy, you know, he told books. Sab open kar do. Nowadays, all this Coimbatore bomb blasts and all that are there. So let me check it, he thought. He asked him to open. So this fellow thought, so he has no escape. He opened it. There was a dead body in the trunk. And immediately he was put in the jail. And there is a receipt in his own name claiming that the trunk is my trunk and 85 rupees receipt is there. And the jailer came to him. He says, the trunk is not mine. I am not the owner of the trunk. Please believe me. I am not the owner, he says. The jailer says, how you are not the owner? It seems that the coolie, you tell the coolie that it is your trunk. It seems that you have paid 85 rupees for the excess weight and took receipt also. How you are not the owner? This man says, I made all mistakes. It is not my trunk. Please release me. He is not released. He is held in the jail. This kartrutvam is like that. So never take this kartrutvam on our head. It is not ours, it is. It is somebody else's trunk, it is. If we carry on our head, then we will go into jail. The jail is samsaram, even narakam. So never own a trunk which is not yours. This kind of, so nobody is there, therefore let me grab it. This attitude is very bad. It is not ours and we should not touch it. Kartrutvam is not ours, we don't touch it. So this is the truth about kartrutvam. You think about it. So tathapi lokapyaya sambhavayaya swamayaya tam yanukalam ruchyati. We go to the next slokam. तस्मै नमः परेशाय ब्रह्मणेनन्तशक्तये अरूपायोरुरूपाय नम आश्चर्यकर्मणे. प्रोबब्ली आई विल डू दैट श्लोकम टुमारो. I have a question. So the question is, what is phalavyapti and vritti vyapti? I will describe it to you within 10 minutes, then we can disperse. You see, the process by which knowledge takes place is explained in the Shastram like this. This is what is called epistemology. The subject, the discipline of studying the process of knowledge and all that, pramana, etc., that is called epistemology. You see, what happens is that when you see the part, ghata jnanam takes place, the knowledge of the part takes place. How it takes place, this is analyzed. Because this is required, this analysis is required for the viveka. Because what happens is, this Atma Chaitanyam is there in this machine, in this complex of body, mind and senses. So because of the presence of this Atma Chaitanyam, everything appears conscious. Even the skin appears to be conscious, and the indriyas are conscious, every part of the body is conscious. So the mind is conscious, buddhi is conscious, everything is conscious. Therefore, the distinction is missed. There is a problem in it. That's why the knowledge, the process of knowledge is analyzed. That gives you a vivekam. Because what happens is, the vision is distorted by wrong identifications and failing to discern things separately. That, in fact, that is avidya. Lack of viveka alone is defined as avidya. So Patanjali Maharshi defines it as nitye anitya khyatihi, sukhe asukha khyatihi, anatmani atma khyatihi. So a thing which is not atma we take as atma, which is not nityam we take it as nitya, which is not sukham we take it as sukha. So this is what is avidya. So lack of viveka. So viveka means distinguishing things separately. So the things are not blurred, the vision is not blurred. Things do not overlap in understanding. They are kept separate. That is viveka, it is required. You see, when you see the part, the process is described like this. The antahkarana, the mind, it goes out through the five doors. Now we are seeing the part. Same thing happens when you listen the part also, the sound made by the part. But now let us stick to the seeing. So the antahkaranam, it goes out through the eyes, and it envelops the pot. This is what is called avarana bhanga. Avarana means, as long as the pot is not noticed by you, it is as though covered from you, as though hidden from you, isn't it? I am not noticing the pot. Therefore, for all practical purposes, I can say the pot is hidden from me. That is what is called avarana. Now I noticed it. It means what? Avarana is gone. Therefore, it is called avarana bhangaha. So, the removal of the avarana. Avarana means the cover, which keeps it hidden, that cover. So, it's not that some cover is really, physical cover is there. That is not the idea. In your vision, the pot has not come. Therefore, it is as though hidden from you. So, avarana bhangaha. How avarana bhanga takes place? The antakkarana, it envelops the pot. And now antahkarana is modified. Like even an amoeba, you know, amoeba, it acquires any shape depending upon the circumstance. It can become elongated, it can become round, it can become small, it can become big, like that. This antahkarana is like that, like an amoeba. So now it enveloped the pot and comes back. It is one round. So antahkarana has come back into its place. Therefore, jnanam will not take place at the place of pot. Jnanam will take place here only. Here or here, whatever. Not there. So, that antahkarana which is now in the modification of the pot, it is called, because it enveloped the pot, and it has now modified itself into the form of the pot, this is what is called vritti vyapti. Vritti means the modification of the mind. That is vritti. Modification of the mind is called vritti. This vritti has now enveloped the pot, thereby causing a thing called avarana bhangaha. Therefore, this enveloping of the pot by an appropriate modification of the mind is called vritti vyaptihi. Okay? Now, this much has happened, but as such, mind itself is insentient. Mind is not a sentient thing. So, mind can reflect the consciousness. It itself is not a conscious thing. So, it is like the moon reflects the sunlight, something like that. So, now this consciousness is reflected in that mind, which is in the modification of a pot. So this reflection of the consciousness makes the knowledge to take place. It is the consciousness alone which is responsible for the knowledge to take place. So now the consciousness makes itself available to this vritti vyapti. All this happens in one shot. I am trying to define it in different steps. It's not that so many steps are there. There is no gap like that. All this happens in one shot only, but we are analyzing separately. Therefore, now the consciousness reflects in this vritti. Therefore, the enveloped, this modified into the form of pot, that vritti is now a conscious vritti because it reflects the consciousness. And then only knowledge takes place. So this knowledge can be called a phalam. So what is it? We have seen. What is the result of seeing? Ghata jnanam. So jnanam is the phalam, result. Result is jnanam. Therefore, this consciousness reflecting into the modification of the mind in the form of pot, it is called phalavyapti. As compared to vrittivyapti, phalavyapti. So when this phalavyapti is there, two things take place. Number one, ghata is illuminated. Now ghata jnanam takes place. Illumination is not outside illumination, inside illumination. Suppose I close my eyes, even if you put a 1,000 candle bulb, ghata is not known. It is not the outside illumination anymore. Outside illumination is required. That condition is fulfilled. Now we are talking of consciousness, which is the illumination inside. So this inner illumination, it now makes the knowledge of pot possible. That is one, ghata jnanam. In addition to the ghata jnanam, simultaneously, a duality is also projected by the mind due to the ignorance, that duality is, I am the knower of Ghata. Ghata is the object known by me. And there is an action called knowing. Knowing, jnanam, it's an action. So, a kriya, jnana rupa kriya. Knowing is a kriya. So what is the object of knowing? Because it's a kriya, we have assumed it to be kriya. In fact, knowing is not kriya. Knowing, knowledge is not kriya, it's not an action. But still, it appears to be an action by ignorance. So, it is an action. So it is a kriya, sakarmaka kriya, that too, transitive verb. Therefore, there is an object. What is the object? Ghata. Jnanam is a kriya, ghatam is the jnaya vastu, object, and then an agent. Kriya means agent. Who is the agent? Aham. So the knower is the projected. There is a knower. So this is all jnana vilasam. So that apart, the jnatru jnana jnaya vibhaga takes place. A duality is understood. So this is the process of vritti vyapti and phala vyapti. So this is how it is understood. So we'll continue tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harih Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harih Om Tat Sat. श्रीकृष्णार्पणमस्तु।